Shalom from Jerusalem, from Beit Avichai. And here we are again in the third and last session in this three-session series about Bialik. And let me remind you, God forbid you have forgotten, that we are in the chase of an answer to a question: what makes a national poet? So when we come to the conclusion of this class, I will review the first two, but today we are looking at Bialik's presence in Israeli culture, maybe in world Jewish culture, about 150 years after he was born. I don't know how many of you remember that, but comes January, in about a month and a couple of weeks, we will be marking the 150th anniversary of Bialik's birth. But our session today, the national poet and his presence in Israeli culture. We will explore that question through three of Bialik's poems. But now is the time for me to include that classical remark that I always make. You know, those of you who studied with me before, that the Hebrew language does not distinguish between the word poem and the word song. Both of them are shir in Ivrit. And in our case today, all three of these are poems, but all three of them have been set to music, and therefore they are both poems and songs. The three I have chosen as our venue, if you wish, or our litmus test to check Bialik's presence in our lives today are Shabbat HaMelkah, Take Me Under Your Wings, in Hebrew, Hachnisini Tachat Kanfech, and Nadned, Siso, the children's song poem. So we will go one by one and explore them as we go. Let me start with reminding you of our timeline. So we are placing it again on the screen, and here we are with the major death. Of course, one could include many more events in Bialik life, but just the major ones. And while we are looking at Bialik's life, we remind ourselves also of major world events at the time. So here they are all, and we are looking at our first session that included these three poems. None of them was, one of them was set to music. Then we went to our second session, which was very sad, heartbreaking. The two major poems following the Kishinev pogrom and their impact on Bialik becoming the voice of lamentation of that time. And now we come to our third one. And here are our three songs, poems, that we are going to look at in the order. And I want you to note the dates. I want you to see how they are quite a few years before Bialik passed away. So we are looking at 1901, 1905, and 1905 again. These are the most important years of Bialik in Odessa before he starts traveling to Germany and after that to the land of Israel, after he had left the yeshiva, after he had left Jitomir. So this is a young, but not as young, a poet, and he is already just before or just after the major poetry of the Kishinev pogrom. So it's not an end of career. I just picked from, if you want, the height of his career in Odessa. And I chose this particular slide just to remind us of the first line of the Shabbat poem. So let us look at it. We are going to devote quite a lot of time to this particular poem, song, and study it very slowly. I want for us to just go through the text in English, because we are going to listen to it sung in Hebrew. So I don't want to read for you all the Hebrew, maybe just a line or two. Hachama merosh ha'ilanot nistalka, bo v'netze likrat Shabbat HaMelkah. Let's read the English, so when Nechama Handel sings for us, you will know more or less what it is about, in case you do not already know this poem song by heart. So the sun has already disappeared beyond the treetops. Come, let us go and welcome Shabbat the Queen. She is already descending among us, holy and blessed, and with her are angels, a host of peace and rest. Come, O Queen, come, O Queen, peace be unto you, O angels of peace. We have welcomed the Shabbat with song and prayer. Let us return home, our hearts full of joy. There, the table is set, the lights are lit. Every corner of the house is shining with the divine spark. Oh, good and blessed Shabbat, good and blessed Shabbat. Come in peace, angels of peace. As we go to the last part, and it's important for me to ask you to remember that we have four verses in this particular poem / song. It will come into play as we will go deep into it. Sit among us, O pure Shabbat Queen, and enlighten us with your splendor tonight and tomorrow, then you may pass on. And we, for our part, will honor you by wearing beautiful clothing, by singing Zemirot, by praying, and by eating three meals, and with a complete rest, with a pleasant rest. Bless me with peace, O angels of peace. And the concluding verse, we are back to the beginning. The sun has already disappeared beyond the treetops. Come, let us accompany the Shabbat Queen's departure. Go in peace, holy and blessed. Know that for 6 days we will await your return. Yes, till next Shabbat. Yes, till next Shabbat. Go in peace, O angels of peace. Let me tell you and share with you the fact that this particular song has many renditions, and we are going to listen to one of my favorites, Nechama Hendel. Just sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Shalom u'menucha bo
that we can stop here and continue with our close look at the text with a little bit of background. So I'm taking you now to the year 1901 in Odessa, where an educator that we are going to meet now, Simcha Ben Zion, creates a cheder metukan, an improved cheder. I must apologize to tell you that the picture of a cheder metukan, an improved cheder, that we are sharing with you, thanks to Yad Vashem that allowed us to do that, is not the cheder metukan in Odessa. There are not available pictures of the cheder metukan in Odessa, but the notion of an improved cheder where boys and girls can study together, where you will study other topics, beyond the study of reading Torah or doing Mishnah, etc., is something that is spreading throughout the Pale of Settlement, Tsarist Russia, and Odessa is one of the places, but there are a few others. This new director, the head of school, Simcha Betzion, hires a young teacher, Bialik, in 1901. Bialik is 28 years of age. He had already published a few poems. We have been looking at some of them, but he now acquires a position to be a teacher. While he is teaching, he publishes his first book of children's songs. And we will come to those as we conclude our class today, but here is the first glimpse, because Hachama Merosh Milanot, Shabbat the Queen, the song of welcoming Shabbat that many of you may know from your synagogues, from your Sidurim, because many Sidurim include this particular song, was written by Bialik as a children's song. And what I would like to suggest to you, that not only is it written as a children's song, but it is written as a tool for teachers to teach about Shabbat. So I'm going to invite you to the year 1901 to study in Bialik's class, as he is teaching the students in his class, the children, what they need to know about Shabbat. So let us start with the first lesson. First of all, four verses that will go along with another Shabbat song that the children may be aware of and we will follow. So the first thing that Bialik needs to teach them is the thing that we always ask ourselves. So when is Shabbat coming in? We have that on our internet site. We have that in our synagogues. It's a crucial question for every person who observes Shabbat. And Bialik is giving the first lesson. The sun has already disappeared beyond the treetops. We are looking, children, at sunset. And now he is literally, as a modern teacher, in an improved cheder, he is taking the kids Friday afternoon out from the class, from the cheder, said, let's go. Come, let us go and welcome Shabbat the Queen. I would like to believe that while he is doing that, he is telling them the story about the people, the Hasidim in Tzfat, who used in the 16th century and later on in Tzfat to go out on Friday and welcome Shabbat the Queen. And as they are standing there, like a good teacher, he will tell them, look, look, she is already descending. I think that Bialik the poet wants the student to use their imagination and imagine that the Queen is coming in. And now he engages them in an activity. Come on, kids, let's bring the Shabbat in. Bow, Netze, let us go. And then, come, let us go. And now that they have come and the Shabbat is descending, I think that this young teacher is creating a choir. And he makes the children repeat, boy, boy, and again, boy, boy. Once they have done that, I am not sure that Bialik yet has the music that we do. It might have taken some time between the publication of the poem and the adding of the music. So meanwhile, he relies on Shalom Aleichem Malchei HaShalom. He is now teaching the children or repeating with them the song, the piyut that we have from the 17th century. This is part of the class. As he continues, he now continues to explain. He is a good teacher. We have welcomed the Shabbat with song and prayer, kids. What are we going to do now? Let us return home, our hearts full of joy. and he will explain what happens in the home. The children know that, but we are now studying all the parts that one needs to know about Shabbat. And we need a set table. There's a table is set, lights are lit, every corner of the house is shining with the divine spark. A good and blessed Shabbat. And we are coming to the second verse of Shalom Aleichem, Boachem LeShalom, come in peace, O angels of peace. I wish, and I think in modern times, maybe somebody would tell Bialik, you know, you may want to mention the mother and the sisters who are preparing all this Shabbat, but I don't think anybody bothered about that in 1901. It's only our 21st century sensitivities that want to pay attention to that. So we have done the first two verses and we continue with the structure to the last third and fourth. So now Shabbat is in, and I think that the teacher wants to prepare his students for everything that will happen. So now they have learned when Shabbat is coming in. Now he's teaching them, how long is Shabbat? Sit among us, O pure Shabbat Queen, and enlighten us with your splendor tonight and tomorrow, then you may pass on. So Shabbat is Erev Shabbat, and then there is a day of Shabbat, and then it will pass on. How shall we welcome? For our part we'll honor with wearing beautiful clothing, by singing Zmirot, by praying and eating three meals. I think this is the time that he will explain maybe about Shalosh Seudot of Shabbat, the three meals of Shabbat. There is a whole lesson plan that I can see here. And of course, the most important thing, with complete rest. I wonder if this teacher would also go into the things that one is allowed to do on Shabbat and the things that one is not allowed to do on Shabbat. But this third verse is for sure an invitation to discuss what does it mean to rest on Shabbat, what we can do and what we cannot. And now the lesson is concluded. We have the third verse of Boachem LeShalom, Tzedchem LeShalom, etc., the piyut of the 17th century. We have the third verse, and now we come to Bialik created a similar structure. The sun had already disappeared, and come, let us accompany Shabbat's departure. We are going towards the end of Shabbat. Lechi LeShalom, which will work fantastically with go in peace, angels of peace. And also the repetition in the class, know that for 6 days we will await your return, yes, till next Shabbat. So here we had a wonderful opportunity to meet a very different Bialik from the person that we have seen in the first two lessons. Bialik, the pedagogue, Bialik, the teacher, Bialik who will create tools for teachers since the beginning of the 20th century to our days by creating songs for children. As we have seen, we are singing, we are reading, we are studying from a text that Bialik had created for Jewish educators and Jewish students over 120 years ago. And it's still alive and still true, and God willing will continue to serve us for many, many more years to come. However, as we are discussing the impact, not only the presence in your own Sidurim, not only the presence in our Shabbat meals to this very day, let us look at some other developments that this particular song slash poem has. So, first of all, when Bialik will come to Tel Aviv, when he will make Aliyah, one of the things that he will see and be pained by is that with the secular Zionism, with the wish to leave behind exile, to leave behind the cheders and the shtetl, etc., a lot was lost. And he thinks that by bringing into secular Tel Aviv a new form of celebrating Shabbat, he will rescue some of the Jewish culture, even within secular environment. Bialik will start with whatever hall is available, but soon enough he arrives. Look, we are in May of 1929. Bialik arrives about 5 years before, and once he's already 5 years in Tel Aviv, they are inaugurating the particular hall that was built for that purpose, Beit Ohel Shem, and we have the whole program of the inauguration, which took place in May of 1929, with a Handel song, and speeches, and Matovu Alecha, a chazan, and the mayor of Tel Aviv greetings, and so on and so on. And of course, it is concluded by Hatikva with the choir of the high school Herzliya, Gymnasia Herzliya. Bialik will be the person who will lay the ground for the modern Kabbalot Shabbat that we have throughout Israel. He started it in Tel Aviv. Another thing that we'd like to look at is a particular quote from Shabbat the Queen. And look at the line, Yoredet, she is already descending. We have looked at the time of the composition of that particular poem, 1901. In 1944, when we have the creation of a very famous Shabbat song called Yarda HaShabbat, Shabbat had descended, and it is created in the environment of the valley of Genosar near the Kinneret, where a new poet, and the year now is 1944, we are 43 years after Bialik had created his Shabbat HaMelkah. We are 10 years after Bialik had passed, and the new Shabbat song about Shabbat descending upon the valley of Genesar in ancient fragrance at her edges, the whole notion of Shabbat the Queen, as Bialik wanted his students to imagine the Queen coming in, so do the poets Yoshua Rabinov and the musician later on, David Zehavi, create the image of Shabbat the Queen descending on the valley of Genesar and using the Bialik line as their opening line for the new modern song of 1944. I am going to invite you to Jerusalem of our days to meet another poet, Rivka Miriam, Tibadel Lechaim Arukim, who is still with us and still creating. And she is playfully playing with the same line. She is already descending, said Bialik in 1901. And she said, Bialik, you know, I beg to differ. Shabbat descends sometimes during the weekdays as well. Shabbat descended sometimes during the weekdays, will say Rivka Miriam. On a wheel or a ball or the sidewalk, within a hidden interior, on the outside of an envelope, is something touched by good and evil and in something untouched. But they didn't discern that it was resting on them, just like that, without rhyme or reason, during the week, without explanation, secretly, only the elderly whose eyesight was blurred and had turned the other way felt in their bones that Shabbat had descended. And I think that the playfulness of Rivka Miriam, her sense of humor, yes, of course, Shabbat is descending on Friday. We all know that. We have been singing about this for a year. But sometimes, you know, Bialik, sometimes I can see during the week. And you wrote your poem song for children. Let me tell you that the elderly can see sometimes the beauty of Shabbat during the weekdays as well. So I think this will be proof enough, maybe for us, for the presence of Bialik, not only by the fact that we continue singing, not only by the fact that our Kabbalot Shabbat that we have here at Beit Avichai or in centers on the Tel Aviv port, or by the train station, the old train station in Jerusalem and other places, Most of them will include the Bialik poetry and the Bialik Kabbalat Shabbat song. But this is not the only point that I'm making. My point is that there is an ongoing conversation with the text, with the lines of Bialik. Like he himself had an ongoing conversation with the Shabbat piyut, Shabbat song from the 17th century, so do poets of today continue their conversation with Bialik's poetry in the case of Shabbat. So say goodbye to Shabbat. We are on Sunday, on a weekday, and we are going to our second poem, also set to music, also sung. So we are with the poem Hachnisini Tachat Knafech, Take Me Under Your Wings. And this time, this is a poem written in 1905, so a few years after the previous one. But I'd like to draw your attention that by the mere fact that it was written in 1905, it is written after the two poems that we have read last week. It is written after both Upon the Slaughter and the City of Killing, Al Hashchita uBe'ir HaHariga. So Bialik that is writing after that is a different Bialik. It's a different voice already. It's a different posture. It's a different place in the Jewish world, in the world of Hebrew poetry, in Odessa and worldwide. Why is it important? Because this is a courageous poem. This is an intimate poem. This is a poem in which Bialik, the national poet, is taking upon himself to share secrets of intimacy. He is talking to a woman figure, but he is sharing with that figure secrets. Let me read the Ivrit, and after that we will address the English. Hachnisini tachat knafich, v'hayi li em v'achot, v'yehi chekech miklat roshi kan tfilotai hanidachot, uve'et rachamim ben hashmashot, שחי ואגל לך סוד יסוריי. אומרים יש בעולם נאורים, היכן נאוריי? ועוד רז אחד לך אתוודה, נפשי נשרפה בלהבה, אומרים אהבה יש בעולם, מה זאת אהבה? הכוכבים רימו אותי, היה חלום, אך גם הוא עבר, אתה אין לי כלום בעולם, אין לי דבר. הכניסיני תחת כנפך והיי לי אם ואחות, ויהי חכך מקלט ראשי כאן תפילותיי הנידחות. Take me under your wings. Take me under your wings. Be to me sister and mother. Let your bosom shelter my head, nestle my banished prayers. Then in twilight, the hour of mercy, bend down to me. My anguish, I will tell thee. There is youth in the world, they say. My youth, where is it? And another secret I will tell. My soul, it is all burned out. There is love in the world, they say. Love, what is it? The stars have all deceived me. There was a dream. It too had passed. I have not a thing in the world now. I have nothing at last. Take me under your wings. Be to me sister and mother. Let your bosom shelter my head, nestle my banished prayers. If you look carefully at the text, and not as many Israelis just enjoy the beautiful music, and let me also tell you a secret that I thought maybe I'll wait to the end of me teaching this, but I'll tell it to you now. Hachnisini tachat knafich, in different renditions, had become a wedding song, a song to go under the chuppah with. And my claim will be that the people who include this song in their wedding ceremony as bride and groom or any one of them is walking to the chuppah, maybe they are not paying enough attention to the text. because I really don't think that it's very suitable for a wedding song, but let me persuade you why I think that. Let's go to the first verse. Take me under your wings. Be to me sister and mother. Let your bosom shelter my head, nestle my banished prayers. A female figure is addressed. You know that the Hebrew is gendered, so we can see that, although the English translation will not tell you, but those of you who can follow the Hebrew, hachnisini tachat kanfech, is not addressed to a male, it's addressed to a female. So first of all, look at the fact that the female figure is not addressed as a beloved, but as a sister and a mother. Bialik throughout his life had complex relationship with women, had difficulty in creating intimacy with women. And the different levels of the female figure, the sister, the mother, the beloved, oftentimes get confused. And in this particular case, it's not a beloved who is addressed. It's the other two sheltering figures. Let us look also at the metaphor of take me under your wings, because that's a crucial one. Bialik did not invent it. I give you just three of the quotations. This one is from Ezekiel. So I spread my robe over you. I'm taking you to Ruth. Ufarasta knefecha ala amatcha. Spread your robe and your wing over your servant, your handmaid. And we have another one from Psalms, Betzel knafecha hastireni, hide me in the shadow of your wings. The metaphor of a man figure like Boaz in Ruth, of a divine figure, of an angel figure that is asked to shelter the person who addresses them, who need protection, who need love, in the case of Ruth, who need intimacy as well, is a well-known structure in ancient Jewish texts. Bialik is relying here, he is not inventing the metaphor of the female sheltering figure, he is picking on a well-known one. But as we leave that particular one, we come to the last two lines of this very verse. And now we come across a totally different notion. Nestle my banished prayers. Kant filotai hanidachot. Now this is the thing. The notion of banished prayers is a well-known notion and addressed in Jewish text, in Kabbalah, in the Zohar. And this is the opportunity for me to thank Rabbi Alex Israel from Pardes, who helped me find the English quote, because I could not on my own, I only found the Hebrew one. There is a notion that if it is a prayer of one, it rises until the palace door where the appointee stands. If the prayer is good, for entering the holy king, he immediately opens the doors and lets it in. If it is not good, he pushes it out and it descends to the realm of the world, standing at the bottom firmament, for among those firmaments below which lead the word, that is the firmament for Shaltiel, etc., who takes those rejected prayers, called the disqualified prayers, or in Bialik's language, in Hebrew, it's tfilot nidachot. So this is now something very complex. What is happening in this dialogue between the male figure addressing a female figure, that he wants the protection, that he wants the love, that he wants the shelter, that we could go with. But now there is a special request. I need for you to shelter my banished prayers. Is Bialik the man taking courageously upon himself the courage, the ability to share, at least in his poetry, that he has wishes that are not so kosher, that he has prayers that will not be accepted to enter the realm of the king. What has he prayed for? What is he wishing for? That he is afraid that his prayer will be a banished prayer, which will not be accepted high up, and therefore he addressing this female figure to accept his not-so-kosher prayers. One may wonder. Let us continue with Bialik to the next verses of this poem and see what else is happening here. So I will read through and maybe we'll take a moment before we go to that one but last verse. Then in twilight, the hour of mercy, not at any time, but when a good moment will come, after she had accepted to protect, after she accepted the banished prayer, there is more. Then in twilight, the hour of mercy, bend down to me, my anguish I will tell thee. There is youth in the world, they say. My youth, where is it? For this we need context. And for this we need to understand the uniqueness of Bialik. The really being a pioneer, if you wish, in this ability to say, he is a product of the 19th century into the 20th. This is the time in world poetry, and Bialik is open to world poetry, Russian and other, where romanticism and youth are celebrated. And he cannot be part of it. He did not have a joyful, you know, puberty and growing into his manhood and recognizing hormones and ability. No, I didn't have any youth. I had a miserable childhood. I went to yeshiva. I came out. I went to work. Immediately was married off. I never enjoyed that which the whole world is singing poems about. And I'm heartbroken over it. I feel that I'm missing something. And another secret I will tell. My soul, it is all burned out. Why? What is causing his soul to burn out? That banished prayer? Something he is wishing for that is not acceptable? And then another secret. There is love in the world, they say. Love, what is it? Now, this is like really difficult. Bialik at this point is married to the woman he was married to throughout his adult life. He did have other loves. He is seeking love, so he is telling us maybe that he did not find love in his marriage, that it is difficult for him to really make love happen for himself. And now he concludes. He is looking upon his life. He's not that old, remember. He's 30-something. The stars have all deceived me. There was a dream. It too has passed. I have not a thing in the world now. I have nothing at last. And then the repetition of the first verse again. Why do I consider this such a courageous poem, not me alone, others? Because we do not have until this time this kind of poetry in the Jewish world. Pure love poetry, pure intimacy poetry, pure poetry that says, as a man, who am I? Am I the man that I could be? Have I become the man that I could be? Or maybe I have missed something. There was a promise out there in my stars, and it was never materialized. If we consider Bialik the national poet, let's consider that aspect, not only the voice of lamentation, not only the voice of crossroad between secular Zionism and tradition, but also the Hebrew poet who gives words to intimacy, who give words to the fact, yes, we are also guys, men, and we have wishes and dreams, and some of them may be not so acceptable by others. And I have had them, and I need somebody to accept that. So this is why I'm saying that I'm not sure that all the people who include this in their wedding song really pay attention to the text. But it is not that important. What is important that they will enjoy the music, and so will we very shortly. But remember, we are looking at Bialik and his presence in Israeli poetry, and we are going to look at a poem by Roni Somik, who takes from Bialik. And Roni Somik is a poet who is with us. If you are looking at your source sheets, please do not look for this particular poem, because this is a session about Bialik and not about Roni Somik, and I'm just using Roni Somik to show you the presence of Bialik in contemporary poetry. And we are again grateful for to both Roni Somik and the translators for the permission to use. So first of all, the poem called Chavadja Bialik. Chavadja is an Arabic word which means Mr. So it's Mr. Bialik, but Roni Somik, the contemporary poet, is taking it not to Jewish, Hebrew-speaking Israel, but to Arabic-speaking Israel. And that, I think, is very interesting. So an Arab girl sings a poem by Bialik on a bus whose wings shade the olive trees among the curves of Wadi Ara. So I need to show you where Wadi Ara is. You can see the Mediterranean. You can see Netanya. So north of Netanya is Hadera. And at the other end, you will see Afula. And the road between these two places, Hadera and Afula, is actually the valley, Wadi in Arabic, called Ara. And there are many, many, many Arab communities. So buses traveling along Wadi Ara would be buses with Arab population. And listen to Roni Somik now. An Arab girl sings a poem by Bialik. On a bus whose wings shade the olive trees along the curves of Wadi Ara. No mother, no sister, and her eyes roll from eyelid to eyelid, the duplicity of Chavadja Bialik stars. Can you see all the subtle Bialik references? It's the bus who has wings that shelter that girl. The curves now are not a female curve, but the land going through Wadi Ara. And this little Arab girl, no mother, no sister, to give protection to her dreams and fears. And she is really rolling her eyes, because what stars, what promises. And as the poem goes on, I once read the first time of a star on the brink of extinction is a noticeable swelling and reddening rim. A red carpet lays over the heels of her lips, and the poem heals click, do, click, la. It takes millions of years before a star collapses, conversation with Bialik, okay? Into a white fireball, I burned. Again, another playfulness with Bialik. Whatever heat is left radiate into the empty rooms of a house still under construction. The sun singed by its own flame is the sun itself that is burning. The workers' blue undershirt with sweat, and the faraway sound of the muezzin call slung like a freight rug over a donkey. Look at the line, the faraway sound, which is an English translation of what Roni Somik had written in Hebrew, Tfilot Nidachot, the banished prayers, not just the far away prayers. Roni Somik, a contemporary poet, takes Bialik's Take Me Under Your Wings into the reality of an Arab girl who probably studied Bialik in school, that can happen, but somehow tries to make meaning to her own self into that very different reality. I think it's a good time for us to listen to a rendition of the song by Miki Gavrielov. And at this moment, I really would like you to just enjoy the song and maybe understand how it is so popular in spite of the pretty painful text. Bevakasha. Because there are a little bit of glitches there in the sound. And I hope you enjoyed the rendition of Miki Gavrielov, which is one of many, and you can look up your own favorites. I'm sure that as we are moving into the 150th anniversary of Bialik's birth with January, we will be hearing lots of Hachnisini Tachat Knafech, as well as many others. Let us move to the last poem song coming from that children's poems book called Seesaw, Nadneda. And I'm going to read the full Hebrew and the full English, and then we will discuss an intricacy within this. Nad ned nad ned red ale ale vred male mala male mata rak ani ani veata shneinu shkolim bamuznaim ben haaretz lashamayim. Nad ned nad ned, it's like seesaw, go down, go up and down. What's up, what's down, only me and you. We are both equal in the scales between earth and heaven. I think that many Israeli parents, mothers and fathers, grandparents have sung this with little children as we are playing with them on seesaws. And one should not waste too much time discussing it. Or maybe we should. Maybe we should if we look into this very specific Mishnah Chagiga. And I'm reading from the middle, both the Hebrew and the English. Kol hamistakel be'arba'a dvarim ra'uy lo ki'ilu lo ba'olam. Ma lemala, ma lemata, ma lefanim, ma le'achor. Let us go to the English. I'm reading from the middle of this text. Whoever looks at four matters, it would have been better for him had he never entered the world. Anyone who reflects upon what is above the firmament and what is below the earth, what was before creation and what will be after the end of the world, and anyone who has no concern for the honor of his maker, who inquires into the deals with matters, etc., etc. There is a clear prohibition to ask the question, male mala ve male mata, what's up, what's down. Bialik is not just playing with a children's playfulness. He is going into the realm of the basic order of the world, what we as human beings are allowed and not allowed. And if I started our sessions with the shift from Israel in your head to the bird coming from real, natural Israel, in this children's song, one could say Bialik is challenging, and from a world at the center of which is the divine, with the set rules of what we are allowed to question and to ask without, we are moving into a humanistic world in which the human is the center, and therefore me and you, we are both equal in the scales between earth and heaven. Bialik has all these facets in his poetry. The admiration and the honor and the respect for tradition with the innovation of the world that puts the human in the center. The brave national voice with the intimate man who shares with us his pain. Let us retrace our steps. We started in the first session 2 weeks ago, longings, as we were looking at Bialik, who is standing on the crossroads between the call of Zionism and the memories of the traditional world. We continued with Bialik in our session Lamentation, and we were focusing in 1 year in his life and poetry, the months following the Kishinev pogrom. And we were looking at the shift from calling up to heavens, heavens, if you are there, have pity on me, and now, not wanting to wait anymore, to the city of killing, in which responsibility, blame, and the need to act differently is placed on Jews, on the people, not only the divine, but you guys, brothers, fathers, husbands, where were you when this happened? There is nothing for me to do, said Bialik in that poem, but go to the desert, and the cold of the desert is, of course, clear. As we move to our third session, we examined another aspect of the being a national poet, and that is the presence that 150 years since he was born, 90 years since he is gone, he was almost 60 when he died, and he is a constant presence in our weekly celebrations of Shabbat, in our ceremonies and rituals, but also intimate poetry, in our textual conversation with Bialik texts in modern poetry, and of course in our children's poetry that we can sing innocently, as I would with my granddaughter when we did the Nadned, and where Bialik says, Ma lemala, ma lemata, what's up, what's down, Rak ani, ani ve'ata, only you and me. I would say only you to my granddaughter and Safta, grandmother. I even allowed myself to change the word, while knowing as an adult that there was an additional meaning. I hope that with putting together these three elements, these three venues, we have quite a clear picture of the centrality of Bialik and the fact that he is indeed entitled to that title that we gave him, Bialik the National Poet. Before I leave you, I'd like to offer you a suggestion. I was honored and privileged to be asked to teach you through Beit Avichai. But I have my own classes on Zoom where I teach Israeli poetry in translation twice a week, poetry, and then there are classes, book clubs, etc. You can register to my mailing list by emailing me at korazim@gmail.com. You can just go simply to my website at korazim.com and check out one, two, or more of the over 400 sessions recorded since the beginning of COVID, many of them about Bialik as well, what we have done here and more, and many other Israeli poets translated into English. So I'm looking forward to maybe seeing some of you in my other classes. And if not, let me just thank you for being present in these three classes. And we still have a couple of minutes for comments or questions, should you have any. Thank you.
First of all, Rachel, I'd like to express my thanks. I think not only are you very knowledgeable in these poems, but you managed to teach them to us also in the English language, which is one level more difficult. And it's fascinating the way you take these poems, which are really everyday poems for people part of Israeli culture, to show us also the Jewish meaning attached to it. And wonderful. Thank you very much. Let's see if there's any questions from the chat. There are many, many comments thanking you for these classes. Just a moment. Many, many thanks. Jerry is asking whether Bialik did not write in Israel.
Bialik wrote in Israel, but we must know that beyond what we call the golden decade in Odessa, Bialik went into a period in his life when he could not write poetry, and he took upon himself great projects such as the collection of Agadot from the Mishnah, such as articles, such as editing books, etc. In later years, in the last decade of his life, there was another round of poetry, and he did write poetry in Israel towards the end of his life. Some major, major poet that you can find a class that I gave on those on my one of my many recorded Bialik classes in korazim.com. And thank you for the question. Yeah.
Another good question from Aviva. She wants to know if there was any competition for the title of National Poet.
No competition. We just continued naming them. So when Bialik was gone, Alterman was the next National Poet. And Alterman was gone, and nowadays we oftentimes speak of Yehuda Amichai as the National Poet. And Roni Somek even has a poem about that, about how he is not and doesn't want to be the National Poet. So yes, this topic keeps coming up. Yeah.
We'll take one last question from Anita, who wants to know if maybe you would say that the lack of love that he talks about in his poems is related to the pogroms that he witnessed.
Could be. I mean, the proximity in dates. The poem is 1905 and the pogrom, you know, is 1903, and the Bialik pogrom-related poetry is that for time. General sadness, general pessimism could explain a lot of the feelings in that poem. I can see that. And thank you for your question, Anita.